हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, माई सेल्फ रविंद्र प्रदीप फड़के, वेलकम टू एसएसटी एजुपीडिया डिजिटल क्लासरूम ऑफ एसएसटी कॉलेज ऑफ आर्ट्स एंड कॉमर्स। माई सेल्फ रविंद्र प्रदीप फड़के एंड असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बिजनेस इकोनॉमिक्स। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू कवर अ टॉपिक फॉर फर्स्ट ईयर कॉमर्स, बीएमएस, अकाउंटिंग फाइनेंस, banking and insurance and financial markets. The topic is isocons, their features and producers equilibrium. So now without wasting further time, let's begin our today's topic. The word isocon is derived from the Greek language with the two words iso means an equal, cons means quantity, that means an equal quantity. The word isocon is nothing but an equal quantity. The word isocon is also known as with the further name such as equal product curve, that is EPC, iso product curve, IPC, production indifference curves and constant product curve. These are the some familiar names of our isocons. So now let's move ahead with the definition of an isocon. Isocon can be defined as the locus of points representing various combinations of two inputs, that is capital and labor, yielding the same level of output. By this definition, you might be not able to understand the concept of isocon very clearly, but I assure you with the help of isocon schedule and isocon curve, the concept of isocon will be definitely clear with you. So let's start with the first assumptions of our an isocon. The very first assumption of isocon is, here we are assuming that there are two input factors. The one is labor and one is capital. Often it happens with the students that they ask us, sir, why we are considering here only two factors of production where we have many other factors of production. Students, let me tell you one thing. The production or the economies run with the two basic intensities, that is labor intensive economies and capital intensive economies. Capital intensive economies like all developed countries, and labor intensive economies considerably developing economies and underdeveloped economies. And that is why here we are considering that these are the two different input factors, labor and capital. We are representing labor as L and capital as K. Labor and capital both are perfectly divisible. Now, what is the meaning of divisibility? Divisibility is nothing but they are substitute to each other. Now, what is the meaning of perfectly substitute? See, there are two different types of substitution, that is one, close substitute and perfect substitute. Here, labor is substitute to the capital and capital is substitute to the labor. Two inputs, that is labor and capital, as I've told you, substitute to each other, but they are at their diminishing rate as they are imperfect substitute. Now, what does it mean? Imperfect substitute, because here we are considering the law of marginal rate of technical substitution of X for Y and of Y for X, means when labor is substitute to the capital, that time capital is also substitute to the labor. When any producer increases amount of capital, that time he always reduces the amount of labor and vice versa. This is known as law of diminishing marginal rate of technical substitution of X for Y and of X for Y. Technology is given. Always remember here, we are just assuming that technology is constant. Technology is given. Technology is basically changing factor. Technology is continuously changing. But here, to understand the concept of an isoquant, we are assuming that technology will remain in the same. Otherwise, in reality, as you all are aware, technology is changing on daily basis. As I've told you, in definition, you might be not able to understand the concept of isoquant so clearly, and that is why here we have the isoquant schedule and isoquant curve. As you can see in the schedule of isoquant, in the first column, we have taken few combinations. In the second column, labor. In the third column, capital. And in the last column, output. So as you can see, there are few combinations A, B, C, D. And as you can see, when the labor rises, capital falls. But when we are applying law of diminishing marginal rate of technical substitution, we make sure our output should remain the same. So as you can see here in the schedule, when the combination is A, suppose a producer chosen a combination A, that is when the input labor is 5 with 1 capital factor, that time the output is 20. And when he is choosing E combination, that time 22 units of labor with 9 units of capital, but output is remaining the same. Whether you use more amount of labor or capital, your output should remaining the same. As you can see here in the diagram, the isoquant, where on x-axis we have taken labor and on y-axis we have taken capital. And when we are joining all these combinations together, A to B to C to D, we obtain an downward sloping curve, that is an isoquant curve. It has negative curve. No doubt, while seeing the isoquant curve, you may remember our law of demand curve. So for your sake of simplicity, you people can easily remember law of demand curve with isoquant, but there is no as such relation between law of demand and here isoquant. Now, we have to understand various properties or features of isoquants. So let's start with all these features in detail. Here we have jot down all features in a very quick way, but in the later slide we will discuss all these features in detail. As you can see here, it has a negative slope, it has convex to the origin, it should intersect or cut each other, it should not intersect or cut each other, no two isoquants intercept either any axis, higher isoquant represent higher output level, and isoquant is oval in shape. So let's discuss all these properties in detail with the help of further diagram. So the very first property of isoquant is being very simple, as you can see, because you have already seen it in the isoquant schedule and isoquant curve, that it has a negative slope. Why it has a negative slope? Because here we are actually applying law of diminishing marginal returns to scale. When one factor rises, another factor falls. When labor factor rises, capital reduces. And that is why here we obtain downward sloping isochon curve from left to right. So this must be very easy for you people. Now, this is we call convex curve. This is what we call convexity. Curves are having two shapes. Either one is convexity and one is concavity. When we are applying marginal returns to scale, that time we derive our convex curve, and whenever we are applying DMRS, that is diminishing marginal rate of technical substitution, that time we obtain actually our concave curve. So here we are not going to discuss concave curve in detail because the feature of isochon is not having any concavity. Isochon clearly says it has a convex curve because it signifies the importance of labor in terms of capital, which diminishes to the labor. Okay, now here you may confuse while seeing the property and the diagram. In the property, we have written no two isochons can intersect or cut each other. But in the diagram, as you can see, two isochons are actually intersected. What does it mean? Always remember one thing. In case if two isochons are intersecting together, means here we are taking capital is equal to labor, or labor is equal to capital. That is an equal amount of capital to the equal amount of labor. But we always considering capital is substitute to the labor and labor is substitute to the capital. Either producer will take higher machinery or labor, and in case if he is not able to buy the machinery, he will definitely hire labor. So substitute is ultimately labor to the capital and capital to the labor, and that is why no two isochons can intersect each other. Now the very next property is here, isochons represents higher output level. Remember one thing, higher the isochon, higher the output level. As much as you can see, isochon is away from the point of origin, it shows higher output level. So in the diagram you can see IQ2 considerably, right now here IQ2 is away from point of origin. It means, or it shows, it is higher amount of production. Theek hai? Next is no two isochons can touch either axis. Again here there is a contrary. Property says no two isochons can touch either axis, but sir, here in the diagram we can see isochons are actually intercept to each other. What does it mean? Purposely we have made the diagram to make you understand, in case if those isochons are touches either axis, as you can see in the first case, that is in case of isochon 1 touches x axis and isochon 2 touches y axis, that is at the point of L and point of K. It means it is zero productivity with the zero amount of input. It is not going to be happen. Even if we are considering labor is substitute to the capital and capital is substitute to the labor, but we have to have take the considerably minimum amount of labor to the capital and capital to the labor. So here isochons cannot touch either axis. This is something very unique diagram you might be seen very first time, oval in shape. Now what is the meaning of oval shape? Oval shape, as you can see here, the initially this isochond sloping downward, and at the later part this isochond is rises because there is a marginal productivity of the abundant factor may negative and the output will decline. So this is something is called as oval in shape of an R isochond. So I hope you people have understood the various different properties of R isochond. Now the very next is we have producer's equilibrium, that is least cost factor combination. Often students get confused between isochond and isocost line. Here in this diagram you can see we have made isocost line. Isocost line is graphical representation of various combination of the two factors that can be purchased by a firm from a given outlay and factor prices, such as 12 factors of our labor to the 8 factors of labor. So isocost is showing input line and isochond shows an output line. Once again I'm repeating, isocost represents input factors of combination, and with the help of these input factors of combination, whichever we are producing the output, that output we graphically representing with the help of an isochond. So I hope now there will be no confusion between isocost and isochond. Here, to understand producer's equilibrium, we have few assumptions. To understand, the producers has an equal product map or an equal product curve, and they are namely factor X and factor Y. Another major assumption here that they are assuming factor X and factor Y are homogeneous and they are divisible in the nature. Price of factor X and price of factor Y is given, means you are not supposed to find the price of factor X to the price of factor Y and price of factor Y to the price of factor X. The price will be given. Price is already existed into the market, means it is understood the market must be belong to perfect competition. The producers are rational, and it describes the producer's equilibrium in two another ways. So now you may find here the diagram is really difficult, but believe me, diagram is as much simple as you people will understand. Now here you can see there is a combination of isocost line and isochond. So now I can see here there are three isocost lines, AB, CD and EF. These three isocost line, correct? Along with these three isocost lines, we have three isochonds also, that is Q1, Q2 and Q3. But Q1, that is isochond 1, intersected our isocost line at two different places. The one is at R point and one is at J point. So at the R point, capital is greater than labor. At the J point, labor is greater than the capital. Means here we don't obtain any equilibrium point. Whereas when we are extended our isocost line from AB to CD, again isochond is intersected at two different points. The one is at H point and one is at D point. So again here at H point, capital is higher than labor, and at डी पॉइंट लेबर इज हायर देन द कैपिटल. नाउ फाइनली प्रोड्यूसर एक्सटेंडेड हिज आइसोकॉस्ट लाइन फ्रॉम सी डी टू ई एफ एंड फाइनली ही ऑब्टेन द पॉइंट ऑफ एन इक्विलिब्रियम वेयर कैपिटल इज इक्वल टू लेबर बिकॉज आर टॉपिक इज प्रोड्यूसर्स इक्विलिब्रियम व्हेन प्रोड्यूसर विल यूटिलाइज लेबर इक्वल टू कैपिटल. सो नेक्स्ट इज वी हैव मैक्सिमाइजेशन ऑफ आउटपुट. ऑलवेज रिमेंबर वन थिंग, व्हेन एवर प्रोड्यूसर स्टार्ट प्रोड्यूसिंग प्रोडक्शन, टू थिंग्स ही ऑलवेज रिमेंबर इन हिज माइंड. द वन इज मिनिमाइजेशन ऑफ कॉस्ट एंड मैक्सिमाइजेशन ऑफ आउटपुट. सो ऑलरेडी वी हैव सीन इन द अर्लियर डायग्राम हाउ प्रोड्यूसर इज मिनिमाइजिंग कॉस्ट एंड नाउ इन दिस डायग्राम वी विल सी हाउ प्रोड्यूसर इज मैक्सिमाइजिंग आउटपुट. हियर नाउ इन दिस केस वी मे फाइंड ओनली वन आइसो प्रोडक्ट लाइन, दैट इज सी एल, करेक्ट, एंड थ्री आइसो कॉन्स. द वेरी फर्स्ट आइसो कॉन्ट इज इंटरसेक्टेड एट टू पॉइंट्स, द वन इज एट ई एंड वन इज एट एफ. एट ई पॉइंट अगेन कैपिटल इज हायर देन लेबर एंड एट एफ पॉइंट लेबर इज हायर देन द कैपिटल. सो हियर वी हैव नॉट ऑब्टेन एनी इक्विलिब्रियम पॉइंट, वेयर एज देर इज वन पॉइंट विच इज एक्चुअली अवे from isocost line. As you can see in the diagram, produces 300 units. What does it mean? It means those 300 units, production units, is out of his budget, because every time producers are not able to make the production out of budget. Whereas in the second isocont, producer is producing 200 units where he got the point of an equilibrium where capital is equal to our labor. So this is what we call maximization of output for a given level of prices. So I hope here you have understood the concept of our isocont and producer's equilibrium. Thank you very much.